operation base to make an object, and then also list management, how lists and information is stored and works through components. It's good. So we'll start with just kind of the basic understanding of what would you use to create a cube. You could create 4 points. So if I were to go to my vector tab and go to point, I could construct a point. And as you see, we'll have 1 point started there. And then I will just copy my 4 points over. So this would be a point, a line, and then a surface way to construct a cube. So we could go, so we'll do 4. So we're going to leave our first point at 0, 0, and we're going to create another point that is up 4 on the y, and then we'll do another that's up 4 on the x. And then our fourth point would be both 4 points over and 4 units up. See how that makes sense? We've got 1, 2, 3, and 4. And we can take our 4 points and make a line. We make a series of lines. And from our, we go to our curve tab and our primitive sub-tab. We have a couple of options. We've got a line. Or we could do a polyline. Let me find out what that is. If I were to type, double click and type polyline, grab that. I'm just not sure where that is. So it's in curve under spline. So in our curve tab, under spline, we can find our polyline. So then we could, this wouldn't be, we could just create 4 separate lines between each point. That's a bit laborious. Probably want to save some time and just create. Use a command that is set up to accept more than one input. So we could just plug our 4 points into our vertices component here, which is our polyline. I'm going to actually draw one of these. So we've got, it's asking for vertices and our final, it's a Boolean toggle, so it's a command, either a yes, true or false, or a yes or no. So what we'll do is we'll just hold shift. Plug all 4 into here and see what it gives us. So it does give us a polyline, but it connects these 4 in the shape of a Z. So it does matter the order in which you put these points in. So if we want to control that order, either we can, so I'm just going to delete that rather than disconnect each one. Polyline. We want to control, so we could just individually place these polylines. So that's our first. We hover over, we want to get our second, hold shift. And then we want to get our third, which will be this bottom one. Because we want it to go from 1, 2, 3, 4. So I'll plug that in, and then we can plug the last one. And to or to have a little bit more visual of or control over what order these in, we can type merge and then pass our poly our points through our merge component before we plug them into our polyline. it actually doesn't close it for us. So that's actually what this command is here. So we could right-click on the bottom input and set our boolean to true, and it will close that for us. So right-click over our closed and set boolean to true. Now created a created a box for us, or a rectangle, a flat two-dimensional line. Now, like we would in Rhino, we would take a line and we would extrude that line into a surface. So just like Rhino, same set of commands. The next thing in our workflow would be to extrude something. So I'll type extrude and grab one of those, or I can go to my surface tab and my freeform sub tab and find extrude. We have a couple different types of extrudes here that you could experiment with, but we'll just keep it simple and do a basic extrusion. So it asks us for a base, profile, or surface. We're going to plug the polyline up, just plugged in there, and it's still not doing anything for us, so what does it need? It needs a direction. So, like we've done before, we will extrude in the Z direction. We'll plug that there, and we've extruded our line into an open-ended surface, hollow surface. If we want to control how high, we would just double-click and get a slider by just hitting a number. Probably, if you hit a number in between 1 and 10, it will automatically give you a slider with the bounds 0 through 10. So that's helpful to know. If you just get a slider, you will then have to, it will default to 0 through 1 with three significant digits. So you have to then go in and edit your slider, and it's just not as quick. So sometimes it's quicker to just enter the number that you want. So now our box is extruded 4 units in the Z direction. And just like we did in Rhino, when we wanted to close some of our, we could either loft, so double click to type loft, or we could cap, or we could extrude again. But in order to do that, if you remember, you're going to need multiple curves to loft. So we would have to somehow deconstruct our edges around the top of this and deconstruct our edges along the bottom. So that'll take more steps. The quickest step would be to just cap that B-rep. Now cap will only work on closed, planar, open surfaces. So if this were to be, this had a big dip in it, it wouldn't be able to cap. But you could do something like a patch. Which would be found under surface and freeform. So you can find a few things here. You can find our sweeps, our pipes, our patch, our boundary surface. That could also be a plausible way to close that. We could just plug our polyline into, now this will be a second way to make this cube. So if we constructed our 4 points and closed the line, we could close that bottom. I'm gonna turn off my, we could just close this line. We'll use a boundary surface, which you can find under surface freeform, and we could just close that. Now, if we have a same, if we then extrude that surface, we just copy this component that we had before, and we extrude our closed surface, it will extrude a closed box for us. So that's a couple different third way could be just to some of these other primitives in your tab, there's actually just a pre-made box rectangle here for us. Center box. It's already here. So for some of these primitives, you just have to search around and in your search command, say box. Maybe there's a couple different types of boxes. You do a rectangle. In which case you could rather than construct that box, this initial square on the ground, turn some of these off. Rather than construct this, you could just use our preset rectangle component and extrude from there. Now, this isn't showing up because it's giving us a grid and our lines are overlaying on that grid, so you can't see them. So what we can do is pull out our rectangle with a parameter. So we'll grab a curve parameter, which is, remember, our black hexagon, or we can find that in our parameter tab, jump to subtab, and pull out our curve, and then turn off the previous rectangle, right click, turn off the preview. And now we can see the rectangle that it provides for us. And if we were to just plug that into one of our two components, either the edge surface or the base extrusion, it will do our work for us. Extrude that up for us. So the point, while extrude, very, very boring, is to think about how you construct things with points and lines and then lofting or creating surfaces from that, just like you would in Rhino. But then here it's the same method, it's just a little more set in place. It's a visual, rather than typing trim or typing extrude, you have an active, think of this as your trim command, right? This is your polyline command. This is your extrusion command. Rather than typing it, it's there and active for later. So now is where I want to show you kind of list how information starts to compile itself in here. So we're going to take this extrusion and we're going to type deconstruct. So essentially, this is another way of this deconstruct BREP right here is a type of explode command. But it will explode this into our constituent pieces, our surfaces, our edges, and our points. So if we do that, we then have a different type of information. So I'm going to show you two things. We're going to get a panel. So again, that to get a panel is \\, enter, or you can type panel, grab one. And we want a param viewer. So P-A-R-A-M, and then it should pop up in that bottom option, param viewer. Now this is going to be kind of a visual explanation of what's happening in our post-it note. So I'm going to organize that such as this. I'm going to plug my extrusion into both the param viewer and the panel and see what it tells me. So initially, when I first plug this into my param viewer, it says data with one branch. I'm going to double click on that and get a visual of this is our tree viewer, so to speak. So as you can see, we've got a zero, one item, in our panel titled a closed BREP. And we in our param viewer we have one tree branch. So now once we have, I'm going to copy these, Control C, Control V. I'm going to look at what this does for me. So we, again, to D deconstruct, we can find that in our surface tab with our analysis sub-tab. And it's the little cylinder on fire, the icon. And we're going to look at what gives us our faces of our view app. We've got six faces. Gives us a bunch of edges. And gives us all of our points in space. Right? Just like we made, we have our 0, 0 point back here, and our 0, 4, 0, and 4, 4, 0. So it's the same kind of, it deconstructs us back to the geometry we used to build it in the first place. So if I have my six faces, I'm gonna plug my six faces, or my faces here into my RAM viewer, and you see there's a color change on that. So we've got two levels of a tree. So you'll see that this will start to make sense. If we were to graft this, it will put each tree into its own branch. So we have like a trunk and one branch right now. If I was to copy that over and first plug my faces into graft, then I'm going to plug the graph tree into my RAM viewer and my panel, and it visually shows us what we're doing with those faces. We're separating them into their own sublists. So now we have a tree trunk, which is the initial box, and then we've broken it into six sub branches. So we can operate now. We wanted to pick one side to work with, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Or like I mentioned before, it starts at 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if I wanted to grab one of those faces, I will type a double clip and type item and grab a list item. I can pull out the very first item in that branch. And I have to turn a couple of these off so that it shows us what is green and what is not. So because we grab it, it grabs us and we hover over our, I'll give it a panel. We hover over our input. It asks for a list to grab from and the index number of that list. So if we have index number 0, it's going to grab 0 from every list available. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, we have 6 lists here with one object each labeled 0. This is different if we were to grab, before we grafted, if we just grab from this panel, item 0, we're going to grab one face. So I will pull from there, and it will just be the first object, the first face from that list. So right here, I've got 0. I've essentially grabbed this item out of that list. And if I want to grab another one, I can type set integer, right click on my index here, set integer to 1, 2, 3, 4, and now I grab the second item from that list. Okay, kind of basic, we sort of went over that with our grids already. Now what we're gonna do is we're gonna divide each face and do a number of subfaces. So a list of lists of lists. So now I'm going to type, you see this still? I'm going to grab two components. The first one will be ISO trim. Looks like a small, looks like a dash grid with a one orange square in it. I'm going to grab ISO trim, and I'm going to grab, I'm going to type domain and see if that pops up. There's a specific one that we're looking for. It doesn't pop up. So we're going to go to our sets tab. Sorry, we're going to go to our math tab and our domain sub tab and look for divide domain. So again, these two components, will, the first one, divide domain, you go to your math tab, domain, sub tab domain, grab divide domain, and grab, go to our surface tab and our utility sub tab and grab isotrim. Again, so isotrim is in our surface tab and our utility sub tab. And divide domain is in our math tab with domain sub tab. Now, think of a domain as somebody's backyard. That is a domain, a two-dimensional domain with a boundary. You have your far back of the yard, you have your side yard, you have your other side in the front. Four edges or a perimeter of that, think of that as a domain. So if we have a face, this entire domain, this face, the cube, that is one domain. So we're going to divide each one of those domains by a U and a V, or an X and a Y. But in terms of surface world, it's a U and a V parameter. It's your isoforms. So what we'll do is from our faces, our six faces of our cube, we plug that into the domain. These are the six domains we want to work on. And it gives us a 10 and a 10 as a base. That might be a little much, so let's just double click and do 3. So we can easily just subdivide it 3 by 3. For our U count and our V count, we'll give it a 3. We plug this in and look at our... It gives us a bunch of raw information. It gives us the exact point on that space or on each one of these surfaces as to where it sets a point and then divides it. That's great, that's a little abstract. Let's visualize that by plugging in our faces from our deconstructed box to our surface, and then our output of domain to our domain. It does something a little strange for us. Give us a bunch of random subdivided pieces. So what we have to do first is separate and tell this component here, tell these two components to operate on each face as its own. So it needs to treat each one as a single thing, rather than treating them all as one box. So as you can see here, it, in an abstract way, it gave us nine, it divided this into 9 subcubes. You count this up, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. See, but it's distributed them across all six faces in a weird way. So we need to pass these faces through our graphed command first. So graphed can be found in our sets tab and our tree subtab. This graph command is also a preset option on every component by just right-clicking, and it gives you a flatten option, a graph option, simplify, and reverse. So each one of these four as an option that you right-click on an input has its own component in our tree category, but they're so frequently used for data management that they're right here. They're quickly available for us. But just so you can visually see that we're having an operation, we're going to pass it through our graph first, and then we're going to plug our graph into our domain and our graph into our surface. So now, like it showed you here in this panel, I'm going to delete this one, let's delete these. Like it showed us here, we've taken what was 6 faces, treating them as one list, and we've created 6 lists with one surface each. And now it subdivides this properly. So our output will be 6 lists with 6 items in each list. So if we plug that into our param viewer and our panel, it'll show us that we have, I'm sorry, with 9H. So we have a 9 subdivided pieces in 6 lists. And you can see here what corresponds between these 4 zeros. We have 4 levels of our tree. We have 1, this first circle, 2, 3, 4, until we get to our 4th level of geometry and our 4th level of information, or our 4th level of data. So we've gone through 4 operations to get to where we are now. So extrusion being 1, deconstruct being 2, graph being 3, and then subdivide being 4 to get to our fourth level deep, or fourth level operation. So, and also if we want to get an even more kind of explicit example in our preview, in our param viewer here, we could graph the information before we pass it into our both our list and our param viewer. I'm going to copy these two. I'm going to plug these surfaces into graph first, and then I'm going to plug the graph into our both our param viewer and our panel. So here it shows us, it's given us a history of every single face and what it went through. So it shows us that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 operations that we've done to get to this point. We have our branch going out here, and then we have our smaller branches, and this represents the 9 different faces that we just composed in each list. So if you were actually to look at all of these zeros, there's going to be 9 of these grayed out lists that have 1, 2, 3, 4 zeros first, and then it'll move to another list. So it shows us up into this one right here, they all have 4 zeros, they're part of the same branch, and then they split into their own item. So we have, at that point, 0 through 8, 9 items. Here, it shows us, and then it goes on further, we have 001, and then 00101, 00102. It's an abstract way of showing us that this branch right here composed of 9, so on and so forth. So, the reason this is important is because how we can select items from this and selectively edit them. So if we want to grab an item again, so double click, type item, select this. So if I want to grab from my surfaces, I want to grab the first one in each face. So we just, back from our surface, we'll just grab our list item. And we can grab the same one from every face there. And at that point, we could then draw on the face of each one of those subdivided faces. So we will grab a couple, we'll grab an area. Type area, grab that. Grab another deconstruct. Deconstruct VREF. And grab a CNR, type CNR, a circle that is built by a circumference of a normal and a radius, I think. A center, a normal and a radius. So we grabbed our, I'm going to preview this off, we grabbed one face, the first face in every list around this cube. And now from that, we're going to grab each face's center point. And from that center point, we need a couple more pieces here. So we need eval evaluate surface. So evaluate surface. And a surface, we need a closest point. So we have a surface closest point. We can find both of those in our surface tab and our analysis subtab. So in our surface tab and analysis, we're going to pull more information, excuse me, from that face. So we need an evaluate surface down here and a surface closest point. Both found in our surface tab and our analysis subtab. So what we can do with this is now we grab from our item or our small subfaces, we can plug our B-rep, plug it into our B-rep, plug it into our area, and then we can plug it into our surface, evaluate surface, surface point. Now our surface point, actually I don't know if we need this. So we have from our area, put our area into our our centroid into our point. Find the centroid of each one of these pieces. As you can see, it grabs us a center point. And we want to grab our surface there. We need to flatten it. And then we're going to, from this point, we'll take our evaluate surface, or our surface closest point, and feed it the point from our evaluate surface, and then we'll plug we'll home run this back to the very first surface. This one, surface closest point. The reason that this is important is because it reconstructs in 3D space to the UV space of that surface. And so for the next portion of the example, that kind of becomes appropriate. But then from here, we can do kind of a mass operation. So rather than have to... That one is circle CNR, and that can be found in the curve with our curve tab and primitive sub tab. Scroll down there and find circle CNR. So from that, we can then extrude our faces. We can extrude circles from multiple, so different locations in space, and it's still able to just inherently extrude off that face. So we kind of, rather than have to go through and model each one of those, we can do a mass kind of operation to that. And we've got a couple of small malfunctions, but because the surfaces are flipped, but the main point to kind of illustrate that is now we want to look back to the information provided for us in context for you. Say you have a large surface facade, and we want to work on this, but we're working for an architect who can't make up his damn mind. So we want to be able to work on this in a way that allows us to go back and change things. So we'll set our curves to our objects here. So we'll select a curve in space. Set our curve. We will merge these curves, and then loft between them. So we've got a nice surface now, based off of a couple of lines. So if we want to turn our points on, like we would, and operate on. Could create, continue to allow that to create itself. Now this surface has kind of got a dip in it, whatever, maybe not. Anyway, so what we'll do is we will subdivide like we did before. So iso trim, and you divide domain. Take our loft or our surface that we created and work on that guy. We'll divide it into ten sub pieces. And again, I view 10. You can control how many we have in that direction, how many we have in this direction. See that? Maybe this is the levels of our floor. So on. And then we will deconstruct this and work on each one of our smaller pieces. Decon. Deconstruct B-Rev. And we'll want to get an area from each. So if I was to just plug this area, okay, it does actually. So now we have these together. If we want to create, so now this evaluate for the surface closest point still isn't happy because it needs a point. If we plug our centroid in there, it gives us something, but as you can see, it also kind of, it's giving us a strange result. So we need to give us the point from which our normal is drawn. So direction of our new face here. So then if we wanted to even kind of create a unique geometry of each face, we could loft our frames from, instead of just simply extruding those off the face, I'm going to move them off the face, just that circle. And you have to supply it, otherwise it'll just move it in the Z direction, but if you supply it with that normal, it will move it in that direction. Just like it would have the extrusion. So it'll move off the face, and then so from there, we could loft. And I like to use a merge first so I can plug which data into which first. I'm going to join my faces of this edge back here, because our edges will be four lines, right? And broken into each one, because we have our top curve, we have our top curve, side curves, and so forth. So if I join them, it'll, you know, close that into one line. So I want to merge my moved face to that, and then lock the... That was a good example of why you need to know how to troubleshoot this. So right here, I join them together. I join the edges of my face together, or the face of that panel, and then I lofted them, but it didn't loft. So there's nothing wrong with the component. It's not erring, so it's not giving me an error message. But as you can see here, the two things that I'm lofting together don't have the same tree structure. This has a 0, 0, 0, this has a 0 and a 1, and so forth. So because they're not recognizing each other, nothing's happening. So I need to create either them, I need to either make them the same, or yeah, I have to make them the same. So I can try first to just remove some of these zeros. And I'll show you that, what that looks like in the param viewer. So when we remove the zeros, we're essentially chopping off the trunk, but keeping the tree. We've got 60 kind of clustered there, but if we simplify, it will take away the two green layers and just give us the outermost branch. So I'm going to simplify tree and do this one and unsimplify that. Plug that into there. Copy that down just to show the difference. You don't have, this is just a visual explanation. So we've got our three layers, our three levels, right? 1, 2, 3, we've got 1, 2, 3 right there. If I simplify it, it chunks it all down just to the outermost branch. And then it also, that looks, it just has the zero, right? So we can plug that in there, and now our loft works. So we've kind of lofted this, panelized face. We've got this unique kind of uniform panel across each one of our zones. I'm going to turn off a few of these things to cut down on the overlay. We've got this kind of unique thing going on. So if I were to go back and change my points, all of these will update and kind of create unique panelized pieces per, because I've set up this workflow like this, works out pretty nicely. something that could even maybe like a complex set of curves, they're no longer uniform. Our pieces will have like 60 unique pieces here. Maybe our program enlarges on the base, we need to scoot that over. Maybe we need to even, maybe there's going to be a 7th floor here, or a 5th floor. We can just turn these down. We have the same kind of, same thing happening across the same space, but we can just control it a lot better. Isn't wide enough, we can go over to our radius and change that a little bit larger, change that to 2, see what happens. We have some airing over here, scoot that point up. So that's kind of list management for you at a quick option. So we can still even now, maybe we've got a problem with. Clearly, we have a lot of problems here, but we want to grab one panel. Still use our list item to grab specific ones. And operate on one. It's grabbing all of them because our data is listed this as each one. So if I flatten this, and grab just one of them. And you'll see that it somewhat maintains its structure, so if I, its list structure, so if I was to go, it'll go in a row, it'll go over 10, and then it'll start, the 9th one would be right below where the other ones started. And kind of inherently keeps that structure in itself, so then you can locate specifically which one would be. Okay, great. Hopefully that was helpful. We'll start using this more maybe next week or the week after. But definitely push yourself in your studio courses to use parametric modeling so that you can.
Typically, it's that you have to spend more time in the beginning setting something like this up, but then later on, if you have to make changes, it's so much faster.
Okay, so I'm going to take a few screenshots for you and send them out. Sounds like people aren't done with possible 3, so take through the weekend, and by Sunday night or Monday morning, we'll have to hand that in. So you can have some time over the weekend to finish up. Okay? Any questions?
Everybody test some money, by the way.
You guys should be well on. You guys should be able to finish before the test. This, you guys have had a week on this last one. You guys should be in good shape. I think we should let it stand. Thank you.